I should probably get in a roll 20 and then mute myself and then die.
All of those are 100% true facts. All right, so last time on A Set of Glass Windchimes, first and foremost, Carol reminded me that I guess I should give you guys loot from both that dragon fight that you all barely survived, and then also the pretty bird dragon and the tundra fiend prowler. Commit eat, Fergus. Commit eat. And then... And then to actually what happened. Malia was swinging from not Evre, almost died several times. It tried to do a dive move on the platform. Everyone managed to not get killed by that particular dive move. And then... In a heroic... a gut-clenching gamble, Thayako runs up, boops its snoot, and stuns it while it's right next to the platform, at which point everyone just beats the shit out of it until it dies, and it did so. Then, the lift, which had sustained quite a bit of damage from the fight, had to kind of be comprehensively combed through by everybody, and particularly thanks to the efforts of Catherine and Kane, the lift itself was basically made brand new, and all the echoes were vacated from its like the crevices between the machines, which were also repaired. And then, after Amalia uses the indomitable will.
The Imprisoner's Will.
I can never remember the name. Freaking eyed long words. After using the Imprisoner's Will to decipher what the controlling mechanism exactly did, they got the show back on the road. Meanwhile, Cyrus posited to Amalia, and I'm just going to say everybody else, because I don't remember who exactly was there, that it's possible that the Arium are either synthetic or possibly come from some realm of Eden. Doesn't seem like he has all the pieces to that particular mystery, though. And Cecil kind of has the realization that just seeing if another Arium has the same weird, like, gaps in their memory and recollection of another place other than Jericho to call on, that's pretty consolidating evidence for that particular theory. Either way, afterwards, everybody ascended the steps to go up to the deck of the lift now that it's begun trudging closer and closer to the Bastio district, but a disconnect happened between Catherine, Amalia, Cecil, and Virgil, and Psycho, Kane, Cyrus. Psycho, Kane, and Cyrus are currently seeing the world as they did during the fight. The storm has ebbed away, and but the skies are still pretty overcast over the wildlands of Narsareth. However, Catherine, Amalia, Cecil, and Virgil, to them, look like these shadowy wraiths that vaguely have their same like body shapes, with little details coming in and out of focus as the shadows kind of wrap around them. To those four, the lift is suspended in a sea of electricity. And somebody very close to the Primaveral in presence and in description has appeared before them. Somebody with a composition of entirely lightning.
And Jonah came up with a terrible nickname last time.
The Prima Voltage. I think it's pretty good.
Yes, but I have to tell him it's terrible.
I'm a second.
I did get reminded to roll the loot from the feedback. There's a 2-tier 2 materia, 4-tier 1 materia, and then 4 things that you can put research to. I'm just going to leave those research things on the screen so you guys forget about them. But as I do the materia, we are going to.
Tornadomancy?
Yeah, that's what every user is using, like the Like, it entirely mitigated the effects of it diving into a whip by just catching itself on the way. Right,
so aromancy is really what you're looking for to make it sound more fancy.
Well, higher is always better.
I want to know the good shit first.
So you get a plus two materia and an amplify materia.
Craig has just joined the Regnum D voice.
Yeah, well, Craig can suck it. Amplify materia. Amplify materia increases the effectiveness of the materia it's attached to by 1.5 or by 2 if it's magical, mystical, or ascendant. Mystical is plus 2. So, you guys can find something with two slots, put in this mystical materia, which is the plus two materia, and then put in the amplify materia, and it'll be plus four.
Nice. Wait, did the layout of character sheets
I don't think so, but maybe.
The item in the inventory and
so tier ones are going to be we get now recording
apparently.
Welcome back.
Two melee weapon special, a utility special, and a ranged weapon special. So the two melee special first of all. One, two. Okay, that's really good for Amalia. You get the twinned spell metamagic for a melee weapon special materia. And you get a 3d6 esoteric damage area of effect for an effort point. Yeah, both of those are really good. Utility special. Motive sense. This can only be slotted into an instrument. You may cast the detect good and evil spell for a point of effort.
And we have anyone who uses instruments?
I don't think so, but you can.
Amalia can play guitar, but she doesn't have one.
And, ranged weapon special, twitch attacks, effort and passive. You do not have disadvantage on ranged attacks made against creatures within 5 feet of you, and you may take an attack of opportunity for a point of effort whenever a creature comes within or leaves 5 feet of your space. Opportunity attacks made this way deal 1d8 additional damage.
This would be pretty good with Virgil's darts.
Melee.
You were thinking darts, I was thinking all of Kivi's guns.
Also that, yes.
Development of magic. 3d6 esoteric damage. Ranged twitch attacks. Utility. Motive sense.
I could have sworn I had a materia in my gun, but I don't apparently.
Alright. So, last we left off, somebody had just introduced themselves as the scientist to you, saying that you weren't the people he expected you to be.
Why? Were you expecting a better scientist?
Are you saying that in character?
Probably not. Yet.
So, from your perspective, Psycho and Kane, So as you guys come up the steps, everyone else probably stops, but you two, as you probably go to move around a bit, and they all seem to be at the attention of something that's not there for you.
Yeah, Sayako's looking around, and she's blinking, and then she, like, reaches over to, like, wave her hands in front of Amalia's face, like, hello? She looks over at Kane and she's like, I guess they've all decided to space out.
So, Amalia, we'll say this is right after the scientist has addressed you. You are suddenly aware of the fact that Sayako and Kane have both become echoes, and one of them, presumably Sayako, based on the height, waves their hand in front of your face.
Kane, that is weird. And then she's going to look up at the scientist. Well, if you're expecting us, then I presume you're the denizen hereabouts?
The scientist looks thoughtful, but doesn't immediately respond.
What sort of science do you do? I prefer to work with botany and alchemistry, but I consider myself fairly learned in a wide variety of subjects.
At this, he looks at you, Amalia, and says, say, you're aware of the nature of us as denizens, right? You understand what it means that I'm called the scientist. Why don't you explain it to your friend?
And then Amalia is going to attempt to explain true naming again to Kivi and Virgil. Alright, so...
Over it. Okay, never mind.
Alright, so... You're aware of the spells that I cast? Sometimes I say something at the end of them, and that changes what they do. That is called true naming. And because he is called the scientist, that is essentially his essence, his nature. That is his true... That is his true name.
So all he's the basically the ultimate scientist, hmm?
Scientist nods. Your friend is a bright one, yes.
Well, I am honored to meet you.
Yeah, Virgil's eyes just kind of light up, and he's like, I could learn so much.
Do you know any particularly good infusions?
Cecil's just kind of like standing, probably like on the sidelines, just kind of like staring at this lightning figure. Not saying anything yet.
While this happens, Kane and Sayako, a shift in reality begins to very subtly change things out as far as the horizon. And slowly, the two of you are calibrated into this new place. And very gradually, your friends are no longer replaced by wraith-like essences that embody them. And you feel this charge in the air.
She's gonna have her mundane ass stick at the ready for all the good it might do here, but she's like, I don't like this. Don't like this one bit.
As you shift in, the scientist, this new thing that you're aware of, its presence right in front of you, kind of turns to regard you and says, delayed calibration, I guess. Anyways, he looks to you, Catherine, says almost timidly, Aren't you here to kill me?
But why would I want to kill you if I could talk science?
There's nothing that says we can't communicate first, beforehand. I mean, it would be a momentous waste to not talk with someone who is literally the scientist, and to not talk to someone like that.
Exactly.
Generally speaking, and Amalia is just shaking her head. Generally speaking, all the effort that has encountered so far have not made any effort to communicate with us.
Well, that's probably because they could still put up a fight. I'm afraid if that's what you're looking for, I can't give it to you.
Oh, knowledge is much more valuable than fighting.
He still looks pretty confused.
I mean, to kill a patron of science, such as... I mean, that would be like ripping up a book full of new formulas.
Can I presume then that something is affecting your realm that you are saying then?
Oh no, I did this. I did all of this. All of my actions are deliberate. I'm not a slave to my whims like the other denizens. Well, most of them anyways. My lack of strength. It's very much a choice. A gift to then kill me.
Something like that. Cecil pipes up.
So that does not necessarily have to be the case. I am very well aware that we are operating without knowledge that could potentially be of use to us.
For individuals that have been tasked with going around and killing the rest of my kind, you're curiously detached from that particular goal. I will tell you, the knowledge I have to give, it's not going to help you. Like I said, everything I do is deliberate, and my opposition to what you represent is very much part. Nothing about me will make your path any easier. I'm just an obstacle, and an obstacle that tried to save himself from this, but somehow you found a way up here.
Were you the one that broke the lifts?
Of course I was the one that broke the lifts.
Huh.
Were you the one that sent that dragon out to eat the electricity in the lifts?
That was a byproduct of my actions, not something that I particularly intended, but...
That would explain why it was mostly a corpse filled with echoes.
Well, what you
see... fortunately, that didn't work, so now we can, and Kvi takes out, takes a book out of her backpack. You know, we could talk about, for instance, page 572 in here.
I'm not going to be patronized.
No, I assure you she's trying to patronize. She genuinely wants your opinion.
Roll persuasion, Catherine.
Okay, where's my persuasion
roll? After a bit of a pause, the scientist kind of regards the book from afar. You feel a little bit of a jolt of electricity kind of move through its pages, and floral biology.
Yes, it says here that if you want the infusion to work, you need to use conifer seeds. But I think that must be a misprint, because conifers don't have seeds. Do you think that they meant pine cones? Or... You know, I've been trying to figure this out. I don't want to make this one until I know, because it could be explosive.
Well, I can tell you that the spirit of the instruction is correct. It just seems to be some details lost in translation.
Ah, thank you. And she puts away her book and beams.
I mean, now, if you're getting a bit of the scientist knowledge, I would like some too, hmm?
You still have Amalia's domain, right?
Oh, okay, so it would actually be sound more like, No, it's just
Amalia! Ignore him. He's not really gonna torture you without the rest of us backing up.
There's just a moment where Amalia is like, if I keep my hand over here, am I technically guilty of murder?
Virgil just kind of reaches for the blood for Isalia's blood sample and just kind of.
Oh yes, that's it.
You feel a little bit of a jolt of electricity through that as well, and its composition seems to change fundamentally, both in color and in weight and density. And I'm gonna go ahead and move over to the long-term clock.
Is Amalia free?
Yeah, she's playing.
There you go, 6-6.
Cecil kind of like sidles over and like whispers into her ear. It's like,
why are we exchanging notes with a denizen? Shouldn't we be, you know?
And he makes a little like thumb to neck gesture.
Hey, silly, this one's a scientist.
Catherine materializing behind the two of them.
Because we're not playing with a full deck.
I mean, yeah, but come on.
Virgil looked at the first, appreciatively.
It's the first time one of the denizens has deigned to talk to us, and I don't want to pass this up.
Yeah,
would you rather go and talk to him?
Ultimately speaking,
I've spent a lot of time talking to him over the last few days. I guarantee you the last 5 minutes in a treat in comparison.
Yes, and that's why I'm, you know, a bit nervous about it. I believe that they're trying to use the Primavera's rather abrasive nature as a juxtaposition to fuck us over in a different, more interesting way.
Roll inside, Amalia. Because that is certainly
an insight check.
An interesting proposition.
Reroll. I'm gonna use my reroll on Amalia's roll.
Okay. Go ahead and reroll that.
That's some bullshit.
You wanna exert 17?
I mean, 17's better than 5.
I'll exert it.
You can't exert it with your own health, Cecil.
Damn it. Wait, you can exert enemy roll 20D, but not your friends? That's silly. Fine.
If you want to help out your friends, you should have played a bard.
And then I would have killed you on the first session.
That's
so you
fair.
Got rid of 17? Okay.
22.
Not that costly for a 22. So, particularly when he said that he has no preconceived notions that he has any other real way out of this, and when he said that he was in clear opposition to the desires of your guys' patron, he was telling the truth. Everything else you can't quite parse, but seems to have been genuine. As for him gifting his power away, that might be a bluff. Basically, his level of cognizance tells you that he probably would have been on the weaker end anyways. He might be talking his past self up to try and scare you out of some direction. You're not sure. That's probably the sneakiest thing he's done so far.
Yeah. So Amalia turns back to him and says, so we're aware, know about the inverse nature between denizen intelligence and power.
Interesting.
You seem like a smart one.
I'm flattered.
Are you going to continue?
Yes, I am. If given them a little help with science, I would like a history lesson.
Ah. He seems pleased by this.
So, I am aware of how your denizens came to be. We've seen... God, I don't know. I don't remember. What's their name?
The society?
Yeah.
Vastind.
We know that Vastind created to fight the... Sorry. Parthen and Megiddo, or at least to mitigate their effects on their race. I can't help but notice that did not come to pass. So there is a bit of a history gap there.
He nods along slowly as you say this, and he says, "That is all true, yes. And I suppose I have to start with the fact that history is always going to be a biased thing, even for somebody as absolute as me. So, keep the source in mind whenever you think over this. What your patron is doing is not the first time it's been done. I was the first, and not only was I the first, I indirectly am also the reason that you have the relationship with him that you do."
Virgil's eyes kind of spark a little bit. "You're the person who dealt with Razorface and Sintra."
He shakes his head. Half right. It was only one of them.
Which one?
The tall one?
Razorface, then.
Sintra comes from here.
Oh, I suppose that it at least explains that.
Well, that answers that, then.
Roll an insight check, Amalia.
Fail.
Alright, you don't get anything. Now with a 6.
Don't think it's worth searching that.
Hey, it wasn't a critical fail.
Yeah, not really.
Yeah. Alright. So, you were the first person, Brian. What? Remove the other denizens?
He shakes his head. No. I tasked him with awakening them. I was the first to gain my lucidity, and it wasn't a privilege that I could comfortably bear alone.
Ah.
Unfortunately, it's led to a path that seems like my destruction is at the end of it.
Yep, seems that way.
Can you lay off the bloodthirst for 5 minutes while we get some fucking answers for once?
We're not getting many.
You're not.
Yeah, but
I sure am.
Better than none.
Seems like we're missing the point, but all right.
The point is that I like this guy a lot better than our other boss.
So forgive me for a second, I ask this. What exactly is the threat that you all pose to our... Because as far as I'm aware, people on our end are calling you into ours. Destruction of the Cheras district and the Cirque district were done by people calling you to there.
That is the likely outcome of a few loose ends being made 7 years ago. As for what the eventual end is, look around you. The Bastio district has long since been fused with Eden. That is, after all, how the Aurium came into being.
Well, so, is the presence of the Aurium going to kill everyone?
No.
Well, to answer that, I'm not exactly sure. I just am not interested in stopping it. This is the eventual outcome of these two places existing, and as a scientist, I want to see what happens.
Ah.
So far, it's spreading like a blanket. It hasn't quite reached ground level, but some of its influence has, and there's an interesting thing impeding it over in that direction. And he kind of waves his arm towards a certain region. I'll say this comes to you, Cecil, first, since your survival instincts are probably the best out of everyone's. It's the direction you came from. And the only thing that comes to mind in that direction is that big gate you passed through where the world seemed to shift.
Yeah. Yeah, okay.
Either way, it's your patron's wish that this be avoided at all cost. And if you're going to return the Bastio District and everything that this blanket effect has affected back to the normal in terms of Jericho definitions, I have to go.
I mean,
if it's already
have
been
you
merged,
considered trying to experiment and find some middle ground?
I can assure you that no middle ground exists without significant structural change. And it's change I cannot facilitate.
If we can
everyone says that
can reverse
every advance in science, you know, people say that it can't happen until it happens.
No.
That's
somebody smart enough discovers it.
It's that in order for that change to happen, we would need two beings that have since been killed. The Anastasic Monarchs is what you know them as. They're no longer here.
Substitute for the Anastasic Monarchs.
He shakes his head. There is no substitute.
Can't hurt to experiment.
It can hurt a lot.
Yeah, but
we're some time travel. We could bring them over here. I mean,
science.
Virgil, I don't know if you've ever read a book in your life, but they literally wipe out nearly all life on Earth, on our fucking planet, and then every plane of existence, every 500 years, and you want to bring them back.
I wonder if we could... It's kind of like with the immune system when you design a potion that mimics the outsides of certain viruses, and then your body system thinks it's a whole virus and then reacts accordingly.
With the reset every 500 years, it wouldn't have time to... It wouldn't to keep the... But I do like the thought. I do like the thought.
You like the thought of everything in the entire fucking reality dying?
No, I don't! No, Amalia. No. I like the thought of us building up an immune...
I meant in the sense of fooling whatever process would be needed to circumvent current events, but sure, that would be pretty interesting too. How would you develop an immunity to world-destroying monster gods?
That's the thing, isn't it? I don't think you could.
So Amalia is just going to sidestep this conversation entirely.
Probably for the best.
And she's gonna turn back to the side. Just like, so you were saying, history lesson. So, how was it that the Vestindians' plan didn't work?
They were simply too late. There wasn't enough time. And I don't think even if they had started right at the beginning of their cycle, there would have been enough time, given that I was the first one to finish incubation, and it took my efforts to wake the rest of them. I don't know how long it's been. But I can certainly tell you that you're not Vestindian.
No, it's been at least 2 or 3 cycles since then. So what was the plan? Were they all gonna hide out in here until it passed?
The plan was to have something comparable to what Paragons represent to fight against the Anastasic Monarchs without sacrificing the integrity of the world. Unfortunately, it caused us to have a world of our own, and it's one that I will not easily part with. Can I ask you a question?
I don't see why not.
And this goes for all of you.
Yes.
How attached are you to your patron's wishes?
I mean,
are you enforcers? Do you do this because you wish it so?
Something like that.
Well, I mean, he kind of, you know.
I'm not a particular fan of the person himself, but it appears as though it's a surefire way of, you know, mitigating absolute destruction.
Well, his end goal is a sound one.
To get to me, you'll have to pass through, well, this. And he looks over his shoulder at the rest of the Bastio district. And I can offer you an alternative. In fact, I can free you from him entirely, if that's what you wish. So keep that under consideration. And I suppose I will see you later. And like sparks, he vanishes.
Cecil sighs.
Well.
Interesting. Well, that's a bit of an interesting thing, is it not?
Not particularly. It sounded, you know, most similar to something trying desperately to get us not to kill it. I have no doubt in my mind that whatever facsimile of a plan that thing has will probably end in, well, nothing good.
It seems like they want the same thing at the end of it.
I have
just
questions.
A matter of whose control.
Oh yeah, sorry, Cycle.
One's certainly more pleasant to talk with.
And that's why I don't trust them.
Look. You're supposed to be all. I mean. Look, that's apparently how you get things done, being pleasant, and...
If only. And he turns over to...
At least that's what... I mean, that's apparently the way that you get people to stop trying to kill you?
It's airway. Anyway, sorry, what you were saying?
I have questions. Let me preface this all by asking... what the hell?
So
it's time we let them in on all of that, huh?
Oh, yeah, it's...
So I've vaguely alluded to this, but we are currently being subcontracted by one of those, and she points in the general direction that the scientist poofed off in. He would like all of the others dead, and then we are to kill him.
Okay.
It's not an alternate plane. It's sort of a coexisting one. It was built by a bunch of people from thousands of years ago.
Okay.
Actually, have we ever talked about the dragons? The set? Is that a story that's told in the Zuni?
Basic victory. It's not a story that's told in the Zuni, but Psycho's definitely spent enough time in Kanan, and that's common knowledge, as well as like the general, like Psycho knows enough about Stossalem to know that her past life is considered a Stossalem.
Right, so you remember? Right, so they built this place to try and stop themselves from being killed by the dragons. It did not work. And there are a bunch of weird cult people in the real world who are trying to use this place to devious ends.
She looks over at Kane to see if how much of this like seems to click with him.
Kind of see the gears whirling in his head, so to speak, and he's just kind of like,
oh, okay.
Not the weirdest thing he's heard in his life.
So, can we just have like an off?
The people who failed to kill the dragons.
Yes, thank you, Jonah. Thank you, Peanut Gallery. So can we just like have a brief flash forward off screen where like they just kind of give the full rundown of what's happened so far to like Kane and Sayako?
Sure.
Alright, so after that, Sayako's just kind of cupping her chin, furrowing her brow, like. So,
and that is the entire history of all the stupid shit that has happened to us up to this point.
It's been a long month? Couple of months? I don't even know anymore.
Several
years.
So she perks her ears up and she like looks up and she's like, so that wouldn't mean Calliope would...
He is, as far as I'm aware, he is... still existent? I've seen him.
Oh!
Well, that explains a few things. I'll have to look into that matter another time. So, what is your plans? Are you going to be changing employers, or will you be staying the course with this primaveral fellow?
Well, I find it an interesting challenge to try to figure out a way for the planes to coexist with each other.
The moral dilemma of getting rid of the planes killing everything that lives in them.
And the Bastia district is sort of fused with... So if this plane goes, then the entire Bastia district goes with it.
We already know someone who was under the scientist's employee, and it didn't work very well.
No. And ultimately speaking, I will be staying with, unfortunately, the Primaveral. Mainly because I suppose it's the W do, W don't situation. I don't particularly trust this scientist.
Well, the problem is we barely know anything about the Primaveral.
Yeah, and we probably will... Well, I'm just saying is that I don't particularly trust the scientists simply because they talk better. There is a certain honesty to the Primaveral that I could, the very least appreciate.
Nothing he said, as far as I can tell, was a lie.
As far as you could tell.
People attract blunt people, it's fine.
He seems earnest about some things.
Well, that's all it took.
Definitely going to have to give.
Listen, Cecil, I'm not making. Oh, good luck with that.
Come on, give him a chance.
So I don't know if you guys, I don't know if I mentioned this to you, but I've been trying to contact him for the last few days, and whenever I get through them, this smart prick just.
I have my own words with him as well regarding Calliope.
That's the other point in which I've been thinking about, is that if we decide to forego this Primavera for a similar but slightly nicer, I suppose, scientist, what'll happen with them? I'm not exactly sure. I don't particularly know them, but it seems as though some people here care for this person. What would happen to them if we were to just up and leave our icy sack of shit friend?
It's not out of the question that in order to get the job done, the Primavera could very well send them under significantly mind-controlled employee, perhaps? Constructing a body isn't that hard. He's been able to do it before, and...
Why is that the first thing you think of?
The first thing that he thinks of is... that Virgil thinks of is deconstructing a body.
Yeah, and also, I mean, aside from the fact that that sounds borderline schizophrenic, it doesn't exactly seem like his style.
Virgil just kind of shrugs.
So,
if he's down people, he wants to recruit others. Do we want to bring more people into this misery?
Will we have to fight them?
You mean aside from the two are already here?
He kind of scratches his head. Virgil.
Well, that is a good point. We're here because kidnapped us. You two are here.
Because we kidnapped you. No, I'm joking. Admitting that.
The scientist did mention something about calibration. Is it possible they're already under his employee?
No, I don't think so. Remember Razorface can get in here. You can come in here with your own body.
A very headache inducing.
True.
Anyway, Cecil, you're under the impression that I am suggesting we throw off the Primavera for the scientist. That's not what I'm proposing at all. Well, I don't trust either of them.
I've got an idea. Why don't we split up? Swap notes. I mean, apparently...
But which of us is going to be the experiment, and which of us is going to be the control group?
Well, I mean... Not exactly a lab. I'm thinking more of a... what do you call it? Yeah, a test, if you will. If you
an
trust
experiment!
Me, yeah, fuck, fine. Yes, an experiment. I'll be the control, along with whoever wants to join me. I think that there should be some people who do, if they so desire, investigate this scientist. And some of the slightly more sane people stick with the Primavera and attempt to carry his will out. And then, you know, whatever.
But what if they try to make us kill each other?
Well, I mean, then we don't. Simply, I mean, it's not exactly like the Primavera has any particular power over us. It's not like he can really get to us, apparently.
That was true while we were outside of me.
Yeah, but, I mean, aside from that, all I'm saying is that, ultimately speaking, we can just lie to him. I mean, it's not the hardest thing to do, most likely.
We're Link. I don't know if you can feel it, but I can feel it. He's recovered significantly the last time we saw him.
Well, that's good.